There has been a surge of violence against women in Latin America in recent years. Mexico and Central America represent 81% of global cases of domestic violence. 1 in 3 Latina women will face violence under their own roof at some point in their lives. This particular recent rise in numbers may well be due to COVID-19 lockdowns and restrictions that have only worked to exacerbate the situations of many women who are living with their attacker. Moreover, femicides run rampant across the region, and the motivation behind these gendered killings seems to stem from specific reasons like organized crime only in part. The majority of these crimes are motivated simply by the machismo and misogyny that is central to a lot of the everyday culture and social relations of nations like El Salvador and Honduras. These two nations I am naming as examples because they are facing the highest numbers of femicides in Latin America currently. Among 25 countries with the highest rates of femicide in the world, 14 are from Latin America and the Caribbean. In my native Mexico, 2,318 women have been murdered over 9 years, according to the National Citizen Femicide Observatory. Recently, the largely publicized legislative win in Argentina legalizing abortion, turning Argentina into the largest Latin American nation to have done so, may portray the picture that Latin America is leaning towards more progressive ideals. However, the fact remains that Latina women continue to face gruesome gendered violence regardless, and this violence is often centralized in regions that are already facing other pressing and disenfranchising issues, namely class and race divisions within the Latin American region. Areas struck by ravaging poverty, which in Latin America is a highly racialized and disseminated social issue, seem to be the hotbeds of this kind of violence, along with violence against trans women specifically, as well as homosexual and gender nonconforming people. Poverty and disenfranchisement also complicate and limit the access that Latina women have to healthcare treatments and shelters. I will be including some resources in the description of this video for information that you can use to educate yourself in the issues that I have mentioned, as well as organizations to which you can donate and aid Latin American women who are survivors of gendered violence. Namely, I will be providing a link to the TransLatina Latino Coalition, which works with policymakers and support organizations to help find solutions to the needs of members of the TransLatina Latino community. I will also be providing a link to Casa de Esperanza, a nonprofit pushing a mission that works to mobilize Latinas and Latino communities to end domestic violence. This organization gives Latinas, their children, and other women experiencing domestic violence emergency shelter, while also working to provide resources to organizations addressing issues related to sexual assault and sex trafficking. Finally, I will be linking a local organization, Woman Haven, which provides wellness services such as shelter and health resources to Latina women in the Imperial County of California who are survivors of domestic violence. My home region is primarily composed of a Mexican immigrant population, and here too, domestic violence is an issue that calls for more attention and resources. Any donations or efforts in educating yourself on these issues are greatly appreciated. As a Mexican man and in observation of International Women's Day, I feel compelled to raise my voice in support of and in solidarity with Latina women worldwide who continue to face and survive these harrowing and despicable acts of violence and neglect. In keeping in the theme with the discussions that are held in this channel, I was compelled to make this video because of two reasons. One, because I observed that there indeed seems to be a rise of Latin American women authors who are specifically focusing on disturbing, transgressive, and horrific literature. This set of genres is used primarily as a way to voice the constant struggles that women in this region face in regard to violence and governmental disenfranchisement. And two, because in this series, particularly on the most disturbing books that I have ever read, I have often faced the question of the nature of the literature which I have recommended in previous installments. Indeed, a lot of the literature which I have talked about has contained as one of its main sources of transgression the constant depiction of violence against women. Now, I do think that there is a great separation between fictitious accounts of violence versus real-world issues around the same kind of violence. It is understandable to me knee-jerk reaction to try and denounce this kind of literature on the basis that it may be a harmful and unhealthy representation of a very real social issue. However, I think that this view of fictitious depictions of violence against women as simply being sick and perverted fantasies is very ignorant, given that it ignores a particularly important key factor behind a lot of this transgressive fiction. That key factor is that a lot of these fictional accounts of violence against women are written by women. In Latin America specifically, as I mentioned before, this seems to be a rising literary trend. The five works which I will be recommending in this video are written by Latin American women, and all of them focus on transgressive depictions of violence, disturbing and horrific accounts, and all of them are available in English translations, which I will provide the titles of as well. But more so than just horrific and transgressive literature, I have picked and will talk about works that have behind the veneer of shock and exploitation, important and resonant messages about women in Latin American society, about the struggles and violence that they face and overcome, and they all deal with questions on the nature of this violence, and more importantly, leave us off with information, imagery, and narratives that will make us think hard on these issues, which are often downright ignored or invisible to a broader awareness of the female experience in Latin American society. Therefore, the talking points and discussions which I will open up about these titles will center around the issues that they represent, and I will be approaching the more disturbing aspects of each story with the purpose of bringing to light the problems and conflicts which these authors have made it their mission to explicate and display. As you know, I am a fan of disturbing and transgressive literature. However, I think that the reason behind my fascination with this kind of literature is similar to the reason why these women have chosen to write about it. Because it is my opinion that horrific and fearful situations, such as the ones we read about in this series, are the ones that can be the most helpful in awakening our empathic muscles, in opening our eyes and bringing our senses into awareness of the horrific situations in which we are thrown, as we read these different accounts and live vicariously through the plights of these women. The exercise of reading, to me, should primarily be an exercise of empathy and understanding, and although the subject matter these books touch upon is difficult and grueling, if we can bring ourselves to live through these difficult accounts, we will come out on the other side with a broader understanding and emotional resonance to the experiences which they depict. So without further ado, please be sure to visit the links I am leaving in the description, and here are five disturbing books written by Latin American women. The first book that I will be talking about in this video is Cadáver, exquisito by Agustina Bazterrica. You can find this title in English under the name Tender is the Flesh. This book is essentially more of an account than a narrative novel of a dystopian setup in which animal meat has become poisonous to human beings, and so to try to continue to indulge in those carnivorous tastes, humanity has chosen to instead harvest and sell the meat of humans. This decision, of course, comes with a hefty weight of various implications and issues centered around bodies, and from the perspective that Agustina Bazterrica offers, centers around the discussion of female bodies in relation to, of course, the production and selling of meat. I think what's most fascinating about this work is that Bazterrica seems to be focusing on this issue of female bodies and the fetishization of female bodies, and of course the very real issue of sex trafficking that exists in our world, and is also pairing it with that sort of exploitative and unethical treatment of animal livestock. I think that she is pairing both of these concepts in a move that very much resonates with the philosophy behind ecofeminism. For those of you who don't know, ecofeminism is the series of theories and philosophies that center around the notion that both ecological issues and feminist issues intertwine at the center, because both seem to stem from patriarchal and man-driven violence, a series of other man-led capitalistic endeavors. And of course, what we are seeing here in this novel is that Bazterrica is tying that sort of infrastructure around meat and around the exploitation of the reproduction of animals for the purpose of selling their meat, and is seeing in there a resonance to the very real issues centered around Latin American perceptions of women, of women's bodies, of a woman's role in society. And I think it is so fascinating and disturbing because Bazterrica does not pull any punches. She goes into extreme detail describing the process in which humans are harvested and, you know, sort of cut up and sold on the market, and the various tastes that people have developed in this sort of post-animal meat society. And I think that it's so incredibly disturbing to just sort of be sitting there as a spectator in the unfolding of this narrative of violence against humans in a society that's sort of become desensitized or has found a way to view what they're doing as ethical or just not problematic. And I think what Bazterrica does that is so fascinating is that she has found that the language that we often deployed when making reference to, you know, meat production and livestock is a language that sort of detaches us from the very real violence and exploitation that goes into, you know, the production of meat. And I guess she's posing the question of, you know, if this language already exists to desensitize us, you know, how far can we push that notion? And of course, what she explores here is that the same language can be used to describe violence against human beings to an extremely dehumanizing effect. It is so scary, the kind of a dark, perverse imagination that runs through the narrative of, you know, industry and infrastructure around meat. And I think that this is one that, if you read it, will stay with you for a long time. And of course, like I said, Bazterrica is raising issues around gendered violence, the commodification and exploitation of female bodies, and of course, sex trafficking. And, you know, this narrative, which comes from Argentina, is one of three out of the five narratives that I will be talking about that also come from Argentina. Like I said, Argentina faces a very sort of high number of domestic abuse cases and femicides. And I think that that's the perspective that a lot of these Argentinian women authors are coming from. I think a lot of people have named this as being one of the more disturbing books to have come out in recent years. And I say that it is deservedly so. This is a very disturbing, but also very illuminating read. Like I said, it reads more of like an account, more than a novel with plot. I mean, there is a kind of plot and characters, but most of it centers around the idea, the building, you know, the world building of the society in which these atrocities are happening. Up next, I am going to be talking about a collection of short stories, but more so I want to be discussing primarily the short story that the collection gets its name from. This is Las Cosas que Perdimos en el Fuego by Mariana Enríquez. And this title has also been translated under the name The Things We Lost in the Fire. So like I said, this is a collection of short stories. And Enríquez is the second of three Argentinian female authors that I will be talking about in this video. And particularly, I want to talk about the short story of the same name because I think that's it's most pertinent as to the kind of topic that I'm touching on in this video. But I think that all of the stories here in one way or another approach sort of feminist and women's issues in Latin American society. But the story itself, The Things We Lost in the Fire, is about this sort of particular mode of violence against women that has become viral around the imaginary Argentina that Mariana Enríquez is writing about. So in this story, it has become a trend for men to burn women simply because they think they're cheating on them or they've gotten into some sort of argument. The reasons behind it are never stated, and I think that that's a very smart sort of move for Enriquez to take, because I think that there is a lot of unstated or unknown factors behind what drives violence against women in a lot of these societies, because I think particularly often men are left unquestioned or uninterrogated as to the motivations behind the violence. And instead, most of the studies centered around the violence that's been inflicted on the women or the reasons why the women may have gotten themselves in those situations. And I think that's kind of what Enriquez is mirroring in this story. But the interesting thing, the sort of most moving and disturbing aspect of the short story is, of course, you know, the viral trend that's at hand, that, you know, we live in a time in which violence can become a sort of trending topic, a sort of viral moment that a lot of people are emulating and idolizing. But what she also writes about is the women who, you know, take it upon themselves to protest against this violence. And what they do, and which I think is so disturbing but also very thought-provoking, is that the women protesting this form of violence decide to, instead of letting the men inflict the violence on them, they take it upon themselves to, you know, inflict the violence on their own bodies. So the women start to burn themselves in protest against this viral form of violence against women. And this sort of self-immolation is, of course, runs deep into the subject of protest and the various form of extreme protest that we've seen historically. But I think more so than that, the story is centering around issues of a woman's agency over her own body. I think a lot of what Enriquez explores in that particular short story is the idea that women, female beauty is sort of seen as commodified and, you know, the central piece of the female experience. And so the men think that by burning them, they are taking away their entire identity or their entire being because they are no longer beautiful. They are no longer presentable to society. But what the women are sort of starting to show in this extremely disturbing act of protest is that even after self-immolating, they retain their agency, they retain their voice, and a lot of the victims of the violence have retained their voice and agency enough to actually accuse the men that have done this to them. So it's so interesting, it's so bizarre, of course, so disturbing and grueling, and yet I think Enriquez is exploring extremely salient issues around violence against women. And so when I read this short story, and indeed the rest of the collection, I just couldn't believe the audacity in sagaciousness in the voice that Enriquez deploys in tackling different issues. She elevates them into these sort of unreal, of course, extremely disturbing levels. But you can still feel that the subject matter that she explores, however gruesome and disturbing, is still tethered to her reality. And I think that's what makes them the most unsettling and eye-opening. Next up, I'm going to talk about a book that was recommended to me by one of my viewers. Her name is Alexa. And in talking with her about literature in Spanish, which we both wanted to read more of, she recommended that I read Temporada de Huracanes by Fernanda Melchor, who is a Mexican author. And this has been translated into English as well under the title Hurricane Season. So this novel starts off with the murder of a local Mexican witch, a bruja, who is, you know, the talk of the town. She has been noted as aiding people in their ailments and casting evil spells on other people. She is feared and venerated within the community. And of course, the central part of the narrative is her murder. And it develops a bit like, you know, a kind of murder mystery, like who done it and for what reasons. But more so than that, we start to unravel the sort of nature of, you know, violence against women within Mexican society. What I really appreciate about Fernanda Melchor specifically is that, you know, all of the books that I am recommending here are so, of course, powerful, emotionally and politically driven, and they're so illuminating onto very real dangers that women face. But Melchor is the one that seems to tackle particular issues around poverty in relation to violence against women much more directly than the other narratives that I'm talking about here. The Mexico that Fernanda Melchor depicts in her book is one that is derelict, poverty-stricken, ravaged, and she sort of very astutely makes the connection of how this derelict economic society sort of elevates the violence that women face. It's, you know, essentially that dynamic of those who are weak and disenfranchised trying to take out their aggression and frustrations on those who they still see as being below them, despite being in the same echelon of society that is below everything else. What she unravels also here that I really appreciated in her narrative is, you know, the violence that homosexual men also face in Mexican society. And there are also, you know, central plot points that deal with physical and sexual violence against children. And that, to me, you know, is what makes it all the more disturbing, but all the more important that we read a work like this. Fernanda Melchor is unflinching in her depictions of violence. And she, you know, discusses the sort of unraveling of every single character that we see who are, you know, still sort of in a very disturbing way trying to maintain social correctness and, you know, upkeep like this sort of a presentable, you know, exterior. But at the same time, all we have to do is just dig a little bit into their lives and we start to see how unbelievably frustrated, angry, you know, morally derelict all of these people are. And of course, how all of this negativity, all of this, you know, bad faith and all of this aggressiveness is taken out against women and homosexual men. I think this is one of the boldest narratives centered on Mexican society that I have ever read. I think primarily, you know, literary works in Mexico tend to be a little more elitist. They tend to deal with sort of more upper class issues, at least from what I have experienced trying to read a Mexican literature of contemporary times. But I think what Fernanda Melchor does that is probably why she gained so much recognition and praise, and this book has won so many awards, is because she was not afraid to, again, depict that Mexico that we seldom see depicted in fiction and in literature. I think, you know, like I said, it's very disturbing, very graphic depictions of violence that I would compare to Cormac McCarthy and other authors like that I've talked about. But I would say that there are some passages in here that sort of even surpass that level of grueling detail that she puts into the action that goes on in the story. But at the same time, you know, Melchor is giving us a very strong message about violence against women, about poverty, about the issues around poverty and how the two sort of intertwine, that, you know, one can be seen as leading into the other, or at least exacerbating the already prevalent issues about machismo and misogyny. So Alexa, thank you so much for your recommendation. I really, really enjoyed this book, at least to the level that it can be enjoyed. And I also, like I've been saying, thought that it was so resonant, powerful, and important to read because of the issues that it tackles. And next, I will be talking about a book that I already recommended in another video where I did my sort of unsettling, disturbing books in Spanish. But I made that video in Spanish, and I understand that there was not a, you know, viewership coming from my English-speaking audience. But I do think that this book is really, really powerful and moving, and such an important read that I am going to recommend it here as well in English. This book is Sangre en el Ojo by Lina Meruane, and you can find this book in English under the title Seeing Red. This book comes from Chile, so we've covered Argentinian, Mexican, and now Chilean authors, women authors, but of course, want to preface it by saying that there's probably tons of more literature of this kind out there from all over Latin America. And as always, leave me those recommendations below. So this is a work that starts with, it's a sort of romanoclef. So, you know, a semi-autobiographical work that, you know, touches on some of the author's personal life. But it's also, a lot of it is fictionalized, or, you know, she takes liberties with factual accounts. But essentially, there's a lot of medical experiences that our main character undergoes that the author herself also underwent. It centers on the character of Lina, who shares the name with the author, who has a very delicate condition of her eyes. And doctors have been anticipating that eventually the veins in her eyes are going to burst and her eyes are going to flood with blood and she is going to go blind. And, you know, even though she's been anticipating this for years, when it actually happens, it is so devastating and grueling. And what we're essentially witnessing as we read on is the account of a woman losing her sight and by proxy losing her agency and, you know, her independentness. So this is, you know, an account that, you know, with a lot of the medical jargon and the descriptions of medical procedures, they're so tantalizing and shocking that that's part of like where the disturbingness comes from, is the actual constant descriptions of, you know, blood flooding the sclera and the veins bursting. And it's just so unbelievably disturbing in such a subtle and understated way. But I think the disturbing aspect of the novel also comes from, you know, like I said, the character of Lina losing her agency, becoming much more dependent on her boyfriend, who is of course grappling with his own questions of, you know, Should he stay with her? Does he even think it's worth it to stay with somebody that's no longer, you know, independent, that's going to depend on him more and more? So the questions of, like, you know, the romantic relationships between men and women, heterosexual men and women, are explored here in such vivid detail that it raises a lot of, you know, important issues around domestic relationships and on women's independence and agency, and how, you know, through lots of medical procedures that can be taken away, and the sort of lack of resources or lack of hope for a lot of women who, you know, face these issues of just medical devastation. And there's a lot of medical indifference as well. She primarily visits male doctors who offer no hope or sympathy to her cause, and that's also very grueling stuff to read. So to me, this was just such an amazing semi-autobiographical account of, you know, that fear of going blind. And, you know, going blind here is portrayed not just as a medical condition. We start to see, like, the world of, you know, being disabled or being physically handicapped in some way, and how that, you know, the difficulties that arise from that are also very gendered and are also, you know, very difficult to overcome for women. So I thought that this was an amazing work of, like I said, nonfiction slash fiction, and just the personal account, the voice through which we are vicariously experiencing going blind, is something that is very, very unforgettable, very, very powerful. And I really, really enjoyed this book, and I did find it to be very disturbing. So highly recommend it if you're interested in, you know, the sort of more medically oriented discourses around womanhood and agency. And then finally, I am going to be talking about another novel from Argentina by an Argentinian woman author. This is Distancia de Rescate by Samanta Schweblin, and this has been translated into English under the title Fever Dream. So Distancia de Rescate is essentially about this woman named Amanda, who is sort of bedridden. She cannot get out of her hospital bed, and she is constantly being questioned by this kid named David, who wants her to give him an account of all of the circumstances and experiences that have led to her being bedridden. So it starts off just as accounts of snippets and fragments of what she can remember about the community that she lived in, and eventually it unfolds into the actual plot, which involves a lot of eco-feminist issues, again, like we see in Bazterrica's novel. The issues that are seen here are issues around the destruction of the earth, and how that destruction also mirrors the difficulties and issues that Amanda faces as a woman in this society. We start to see that she lives in a society that is very dependent sort of on motherly love, and she constantly worries about her daughter. And this sort of motherly interactions are so resonant, but they sort of intertwine with the broader sort of ecological narrative about this chemical that has been poisoning the water in the rural community that Amanda lives in, and how it's slowly sort of taking away the children of the community one by poisoning them and killing them. And it also explores issues of transmigration, which is sort of a more metaphysical, fantastic take, which I also very much enjoyed it being injected into this very real sort of social realism setup. And ultimately, it's a novel about, you know, motherly love, and how that is problematized or made difficult in circumstances, you know, that center around, again, poverty, like we see in Melchor's novel. You know, this derelict, sort of hopeless, societally dysfunctional land that she lives in, that's been poisoned, that's killing animals, that's killing children, and a woman's sort of trauma around trying to, you know, make sure that her child is safe, but also trying to herself survive and make sense of an Argentina that is slowly falling victim to the influences of, you know, the reorganization of infrastructure, the exploitation of the land. It's basically a story about how, you know, society sort of falls apart in an apocalypse that is seen through the eyes of a woman. So I thought, you know, it's a very sort of surreal work of literary fiction that, you know, also touches on very real issues. And as I've said, I think before, sometimes, you know, the use of surreal descriptions is all that some authors have to make sense of what is essentially a very surreal situation. Because as we see here, Samanta Schweblin is writing about very real issues around the harvesting of soybeans and other crops that are, you know, being infused with pesticides all across Argentina, and how this has led to deformities, how this has led to, you know, the killings of wildlife, and the way that she mixes it with, you know, a woman's issues around motherhood and concern is just so fantastic and you know, tantalizing. And I really, really enjoyed this work. And ultimately, the ending is very hopeless. But, you know, I think that Samanta Schweblin is purposely doing that because she wants to, you know, sort of raise an awareness of issues that are, you know, long overdue for reevaluation and solution. So, you know, if you're interested in that kind of narrative, essentially, it is kind of a horrific story. And, you know, there's a lot of disturbing descriptions about deformities and death and poisoning and, you know, changes in the body. And, you know, again, it's very centered on, like, you know, the female reproductive system. And it's just very, you know, unsettling, hopeless, you know, very bleak view of, you know, contemporary times in Argentina, but also very powerful and important read. So there are my five recommendations on disturbing literature written by Latin American women who are using disturbing and transgressive fiction to tackle very real social issues revolving around women. I'm doing this in observation of International Women's Day. Please let me know if you have read any of these titles or if you have any other titles written by either Latin American women or just women authors that, you know, sort of use the conventions of transgressive fiction or horror fiction to sort of tell very real stories about women facing very real issues, because I think this is a topic that as of late has really fascinated me and I want to learn more about it. And like always, thank you for watching. Don't forget to check out the resources that I'm leaving in the description if you want to donate or learn of other ways that you can help. And thank you, and I will see you again whenever I put out my next video. So have a wonderful day. Bye.